Back. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another episode of Geekdown. I am Pat B. On the side of right here, the champ from parts unknown, Black Adam.
Yes, sir. How we doing, Patrice?
Okay, on this Labor Day.
Labor
Day? Yeah, Labor Day. Yeah.
Did you work today?
Kind of. I did a lot of stuff. This show was hosting gigs up. I've got coming up, man. It never stops.
No, I can't. Got to make that money, man.
Oh, for real, for real. And a man who knows all about making that money over there, trying to look like non-descript and like disclosed. He's really got like, I thought he had like serious business and stocks on there. He got porn on the computer. I can see it from here. Just Johnny.
Yeah, baby.
Crooked stuff over there.
There's some horses going on.
I didn't mean to call you out on air, man. I just thought our Twitch viewers would like to know exactly what's happening in the background.
They're probably getting the live feed right now anyway. So.
Oh, yeah, they can see.
That's right. The barn is open.
Okay, well, I promise you all those actors are over 18 in human and in dog years. All right. Of course,
get
over
him,
there,
Massey.
This dude looking disgusted in the back is DJ Herbie Herb.
Hey, guys.
Oh, man. We started off on a bad, bad note, but still we have an action-packed, fun-filled show for you. As always, dude, I got to check out Vixen, the animated series. We're going to delve into that. I got to read a new comic from Dynamite, a company we don't talk about too often on here. Moneypenny.
Yeah.
Yeah, from the James Bond universe, Moneypenny got her own one-shot, and we're going to lay into it in a bit.
Yeah, they've got a bunch of good Bond stuff going on. I haven't really read most of those, but I have checked out a few, and they're great. So this one was fantastic as well, so we'll get into that for sure.
Yes we will. And dude, Johnny and I got a taste of a game that brings me
the
back
80s.
To when video game, yeah, exactly,
yeah,
when gaming was raw, you know, when it was rough.
Yep.
You know, it took no prisoners. You know, the games hated you and they wanted you to know it,
and psychedelic colors was the only palette.
Exactly. Like, hard drugs were being done. None of this. I did weed and maybe LSD. I'm
I did
like,
weed
exactly.
In the 80s.
I did some of that there weed. You know, the marijuanas. I experimented with the marijuanas.
This,
you know,
is what one marijuanas can do to you.
Each one of them. The multiple marijuanas.
All the hard times right there.
All right. And, dude, and we also got... I was really hoping Mix McCobb could be on this show because we have Death Note. Netflix's Death Note. Not the old school... not the original animated Death Note, but Netflix's new live-action Death Note adaptation.
Of the manga?
Oh, man, I got some stuff to say. Well, the anime was an adaptation of the manga.
Mm.
And now we have live-action adaptation of the anime.
Oh.
Yes, it's going to get special.
It does sound like one.
A Western take on the anime. Manga or the anime. I'm not sure which one. I didn't.
An adaptation of an anime.
I'm not familiar with either of those, so I watched a movie.
Yeah, it's a Western take of the anime itself, which I'm not going to automatically cut it down for that because there's so many other reasons to cut it down. But first, I'm going to ask DJ Herbie Herb over there. Are you an anime fan, my friend?
Yeah.
Cool. Are you a comic fan, my friend?
Of course I am.
Are you a gaming fan, my friend?
Sometimes.
Are you a comic fan, my friend?
Yes.
I see that twice. See, it's okay. No. It's all good because
consistency.
We have stuff for you, my friend. And I want you to be aware. It's going to get amazing.
Woo!
Yeah. All right, but no, first off, let's jump into Moneypenny. James Bond's Moneypenny in her own one-shot. Now, the Moneypenny character, anyone who doesn't know, has for a long time been the secretary to M, James Bond's boss and the head of MI6 in the Bond universe. And it wasn't until the last couple Bond movies that they started really fleshing out the character.
Giving her actually something to do.
Exactly.
Yeah, other than be hit on by Bond.
Yo, that was like the that was the long standing run of the character. The definition of Moneypenny was the really thirsty office chick that James Bond teased but never really got with.
Mm.
I feel like he threw one or two.
It's suggested for sure. You never really get that satisfaction of knowing, but you definitely felt that it happened.
Mm.
But definitely in the past few Bonds, she was actually a field agent for a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And before she was the his office mate.
I like that dude, because before she was just like the thought that's behind the desk.
Right.
This dude comes in and plays with it every now and then. But it was kind of – it's a good character to have once or twice for comedic purposes. When we consider the woman herself, it's really just like a base – almost nothing character.
Definitely, that, yeah.
Yeah, you know, and now she's become more of like a prominent, powerful female figure, which is tight. This book goes out of its way to emphasize that, which I actually really liked.
Yeah, and definitely goes from it bounces back from like then and now, like from current time to like her training and everything like that. So it gives her a wider berth in terms of like her character. So you get to pick up a bunch about her.
Believe it or not, that style of storytelling actually almost that almost turned me off to it, because that confused me a little bit, because I'm like, we're learning about this character, but we know this character. I kind of just want to see her in action already.
Okay.
You know, and what they did was they're showing her, it's like, now she's in the field. Cool, we're starting off on that point. Some stuff's going to go down, or we're going to establish a solid story, and we're skipping all the early stage BS. Nope, then it flashes back to her being a child for some reason. And I'm thinking this is going to develop into something later on, and it's going to make a lot more sense. Then I just have to keep reading. They never go back to
it. It's like, no, she's just a kid.
Yeah. Once. As far as best as I can figure, this would be if they're painting her personality type for a character we know nothing about. But because we know the character, they're probably figuring, we'll throw this in the background and they'll see, oh, I guess this is where she came from. And then flash back to the movies and the lines she had there, the exchanges she had there, and the relationship she had there. But what if I've never seen her in the movies? Right. You know, what if I've only seen the Sean Connery and Pierce Brosnan and James Bond? I would have no idea this character does anything come out from behind the desk. I wouldn't even know why she's black. You know, so it's like it's relying too much on having that foreknowledge, which, to be fair, a lot of people will have going in.
Well, she basically killed Bond in the last movie, didn't she?
But you know, they always kill Bond.
Kind of. Yeah.
Bond has died at least 17 times.
And those are just from STDs.
No one has survived more burning crotch
right, yeah.
than James Bond. In fact, we should test his blood, man. I'm pretty sure he's got the cure for AIDS.
Yeah, whatever's like inflicting the world now, he's probably got the cure for it anyway in his blood.
Gonorrhea, HPV, athlete's foot, you name it, Bond's got the cure in his DNA. We got to get down with that. But all right, back to this actual story of a character that's completely unrelated. Not unrelated, but was not involved in that in this book. Writer Jody Hauser and new artist Jacob Edgar approach a new character and a new mission involving Moneypenny. Friend of James Bond, former MI6 field agent, and bodyguard of M. Right there, they're already expanding the character. M, Moneypenny was always M's secretary and only the secretary. And this one, they've expanded it to M is a protected figure. And Moneypenny is the one who not just mans the desk, but also watches his back. You know, is there in kind of like a covert role of, it seems like she's just an office worker, but she's actually the one with the eagle eye on the big boss at all times.
Because she's definitely the most trusted person in that role. Yeah.
You know what? That actually, I thought they would have a hard time working into why she's been behind desk this whole time and why that's the only role we've known her in.
Mm-hmm.
And they really did their best to make that make more sense.
No, it's definitely addressed, which was good, yeah. too. Because you're kind of like, well, what the hell are you going
to
explain this?
Well, the movies kind of glossed over it. In the movies, it's, at least to me, my interpretation of her role in the movies was she was a field agent, she was green, she got into a lot of stuff early on, and then her choosing to be behind the desk was just her saying, I need a bit more of a more or less action-oriented role, but still within this organization.
Right.
And it seemed like someone who was maybe shell-shocked taking on early retirement, this made it more legitimate. This made it more of a story I want to hear.
Yes.
Yeah. Which I did like, dude. I think it's safe to say I did like this book. My one of my major complaints is that it was really short. It was sold as a one-shot, but it's a one-shot that's written as if it's going to be an ongoing series. And I think that's pretty presumptuous at this point.
Which it may. I would definitely read more for sure.
I would love it if it did. But if you're going to paint yourself as a one-shot, have a story that has like a bunch of things happening. You know, this painted backstory of a character that we already kind of knew and then didn't really take it to that many places. You know,
yeah,
it's a one-shot and she goes on what looked to me like half a mission.
It definitely needed to come to a more definite conclusion as well. I think you're right.
Also, since they painted her as a badass and an agent who's aware of all stuff, who can kick ass, take names, blow cats away, she's sniping with a handgun. Like, what the... Mm? But that was dope. I wanted more of that. I wanted so much more. And there is action in this, but nowhere near as much as you'd expect from a James Bond title. Any related character in there still carries the name and reputation in the universe of James Bond. And it's written a lot like, if you're familiar with this, not many people will. I hope I don't lose too much of the audience. But it's written like one of the old school Ian Fleming books. Where characters were were more realistic, less superheroic, as James Bond has become in the films. And it took more time to develop story and establish characters and then work in background stuff. It was espionage books.
Well, that's what I think this Daniel Craig run has kind of tried to bring back, because definitely like the Pierce Brosnan run was like invisible cars, ice mansions, and things like that. And you're like, this is just absolutely ridiculous. You know, it totally got away from anything that Bond should have been.
Yeah.
And so it was definitely good to see the Daniel Craig run where it's kind of more gritty, true to life. And so I think this book is definitely kind of running in that same thing. So
I did notice you also use the Walther PPK.
Yes.
Yeah. But dude, okay.
They got a choice, obviously.
Well, this bugged me. It's a James Bond universe book. She's working for MI6, protecting M himself. No gadgets. She didn't have like a watch with a garrote wire or anything, you know, none of the most basic stuff.
Not even a radio.
That seemed like a failing, though, because it takes place today, and there was no, like, real communication device. They have to find a cell phone on a dead
guy. Could have had a fog machine and something. You know what I mean? Like a laptop or something.
Exactly. I want to see, like, some ball bearings jacks fall on the back of her shoe, so if she's being chased, yes. Somebody, like, steps on some spikes.
A bunch of matchbox, fall out of the back of her heels.
Oil slick.
Yep. Yeah. Out of her stilettos. Sure. Something.
These are golden ideas. Why weren't they used?
Oh, she should write her own book. This is what's going on.
She throws an earring. It turns out to be a grenade. Dude, oh, okay. If any of these ideas show up in the next issue, if they do a follow up, I want royalties.
Yeah,
you're saying
it
first, okay? This is on September 4th, 2017. I want to see my residuals. All right, but the book is called, James Bond: Moneypenny, and it's by Dynamite Comics. It's a one shot only for now, but I mean, it's available online. And you can find it at your local comic shop. You may have to request it if it's a more popular shop, if your regular subscription box is like a Newberry Comics or something. And if it is, why? But I think it's definitely worth a read at least. It's called James Bond, Moneypenny. I recommend it. Adam?
Absolutely. Okay, absolutely. So, it's good to see Moneypenny get some do. You know?
Moneypenny get some do instead of just trying to get some do. Well, anyways, it's written by Jody Houser, too. This is just a side note. Jody Houser, I've read a couple more things by her. And she's a writer who, it's not, her work isn't blatantly feminist, but she goes out of her way to write more realistic female characters, which is interesting. It was new to see. There's another book, I forget the name of it. It was about this not necessarily superhero team, but a team of specialists that had a couple metahumans on it, you know, and one of them is like this fat woman, you know, who, how many times do you see a fat field agent?
You don't.
I just thought that was poignant.
There's a good one-off joke in this one too, where she says something to somebody. She's like, "What do you expect me to smile next?"
Or
asking me to smile next. That's what every woman gets. You know what I mean? Why do you smile
the dude
more?
Dude, tried to hit on her on the plane.
Why do you smile more? It's like, yeah, that's just addressing that can of guy. It was just so perfect too. Yeah, so it's coming from someone with experience. Obviously, you had to write that. Yeah. Someone. It's so good.
All right. Well, the writer's Jody Houser. The book is called James Bond: Moneypenny. Dude, I recommend checking it out. It receives our seal of approval. If you have anything to say on the book, maybe you've read it, you want to check it out, you want to, you know, give us some inside information, whatnot, hit us up at geekdownradio@gmail.com. Or, I mean, dude, we're on Twitch. You can chime in and jump into the chat, or look up the video on YouTube, leave a comment there. Let us know what's going down, what's good. All right. Now, oh, boy. Adam, my friend,
mm-hmm.
We need to have a conversation
about
Netflix's Death Note.
All right.
Now, first of all, I'm familiar with Death Note, the anime.
And I'm not.
You're not? Okay.
Not.
Herb?
I watched the Japanese live version movies.
Okay, that's good. There were original live version movies released in Japan, and you can find them online here in the West, but they were not produced by Western studios. That's actually a very important distinction. I want you to chime in if you can.
Okay.
And Johnny, you were familiar with the manga, right?
No, not the manga. A little bit from the anime, only from what people have told me about. So I do know that it's about this student who mm-hmm. gets a hold of this book, and that there's a bunch of rules. I don't know what the rules are, but there's a bunch of
the
rules.
The rules are you can't feed the Shinigami at midnight.
Yep.
You can't
no
get
water
them wet.
On them. Yep.
Don't get them wet. Yep. And then
no, that's the Gremlin rule. Yeah,
I think so.
The basic premise is that whatever name he writes into this book, that particular person will die, and they can sort of dictate how they're going to die and do control various aspects of their life.
That is correct. Now all the rules are meant to keep things within due bounds and also allow the Shinigami to either pay attention and follow, you know, the laws laid down by the actual writer in the Death Note, or to have fun and go completely batshit crazy. And I'll break it down for anyone who's not familiar with the concept here, because we're talking about Death Note, the live action version, released recently on Netflix. It's available now. You can check it out. I believe it's free on Netflix as well. And it's,
as long as you have a subscription.
Well, I mean, that's how you watch Netflix.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. It's free as long as you have a subscription, yo.
It's free as Netflix. Long as you pay, right? Pay monthly.
All right. Calling out my ignorance. Thank you. Actual plot breakdown is a high school student discovers a supernatural notebook that has deadly powers. He can kill anyone he wishes simply by inscribing their name within its pages. Intoxicated with this new power, he begins to eliminate those he deems unworthy of life. That sounds very ominous, very badass, and in the anime, it kind of is. It becomes more of a cat and mouse game, more of a cerebral thing, but at its crux, that is Death Note.
Yeah, it's pretty messed up.
Really?
When you think about it.
Well, I think all cats I know, I wouldn't want any of those
you got a
with
death,
the power to
you
kill
have a death
off
list?
Pat? I don't have a death list.
I mean, but you have a few people. I mean, that come to mind. Like, okay,
I'm not,
so
I'm not admitting anything that's going to get some like government agencies knocking on my door.
Very true. Right. But yeah, let's just, can you acknowledge that, like, when you think of something like this, and instantly, like, two names pop up?
Oh, yes.
All right.
Cool. I think more than two.
Yeah.
But they got juice. Right. I'm not messing with any.
Exactly.
And it definitely, so I think what you'd expect from that initial premise of being able to write and kill anyone that you want, what you expect for a story is a revenge story of being able to unleash your vindictive nature upon people that sort of crossed you.
Oh yeah, no, you pity the
history.
Kind of like revealing this darker side of yourself, right. I think, is, yeah.
But the movie,
if you're doing it for justice.
But the movie, and I
which
think
no one's ever doing
more
it
so
justice.
With the anime itself and the manga,
justice you need to do.
Is that it goes way beyond that. It takes that initial idea of just getting vengeance and takes it way further into this level that is well thought out in the anime and manga, but within this movie, it turns into kind of a negative because it just it skips a lot of interesting things.
Oh, yeah,
it goes through a lot of story. It pretty much, I think it covers the entirety of the story, or at least that's what it felt like, because it covered so much territory storyline-wise, and it covered it within 10 minutes, 15 minutes.
This it's a 2-hour, actually it's a less than 2-hour movie that tries that actually put really forces in the rise and fall of the relationship between Light and L, the investigator that's looking deeply into the case. L specially brought in, has a special set of skills, and believes he himself is the perpetrator. It's a really complex story that, if you watch the anime, and I can't speak for the manga, from the anime I watched it and it had a lot of good, like, nuanced tension that really sucks you in. And in the movie, I'm sorry, it's not at all. And that's a problem because it's not my favorite anime, but it's one that I definitely think is a good, solid suspense story. Like, I would hold this up with anything by like David Fincher, you know.
Really?
Yeah, no, this was on point as a story, the anime itself. And then this live-action interpretation was, I mean, forgive me, it was just a bastardization of something that was solid and had a really interesting structure. And it felt like the cash grab that I'm sure it was.
Some things just don't translate that well, you know what I mean? Especially like you're going from one medium to the next, there's obviously some stuff lost in translation.
Yeah, that's what it feels like. It feels like because there's so much things being covered in the anime and the manga, or the manga first and the anime or whatever, there's so much material there. It's kind of like how there's a Stephen King film that's made from what?
The Stand.
The Stand.
It's a 5-hour movie made off of a 106.
That is an 8-hour movie.
8 hours. Damn. Yeah. Okay. I saw the abridged version, apparently.
Yeah, it's basically something like that, where you're taking like this big, giant story and condensing it into 2 hours, or in this case, I think it was only like an hour and 40 minutes. Maybe it was a little bit longer than that.
It went by pretty quick. It would, dude. Why? They could have. It's Netflix. Extended at the very least. You know, do a multi-episode. Could have made a
8-episode run of it. You know what I mean?
That would have been great. Right. Yeah.
It would have. It definitely would have been better in a TV series like format than it would have.
That
in
you can
a
just
movie.
Chew down in like a day.
Yeah. I will call out the acting of. Not the main kid. Not screw. The acting of Keith Stansfield. Keith Stansfield, you probably don't know him. He's done a couple of shows, but he's never really like the top guy. And this is kind of messed up, but he played L, by the way. He played L, and I thought he did a pretty good job.
Oh yeah.
But really good. The biggest claim to fame right now is, I mean, everyone will know his face, even if you don't know his name, but not really anything else he's done performance wise, unless you pay attention to the shows. Do you remember in Get Out? There's one pivotal scene, but also one of the most prominent scenes from the commercials, where you see the guy with the straw hat and his nose starts bleeding. He's like, "Get out! Get out!"
No way.
He grabs him. That dude. That's Keith Stansfield. He's a good actor. He's done some good stuff, but that's like the main thing you recognize him
from. Yeah, he's kind of up and coming. He did Short Term 12 was a movie he did that he was great in as well. Mm-hmm. So yeah, he's definitely. On the up.
Yep, the cat's on point. He had an interesting portrayal of L. It wasn't exact to the anime. Maybe it was more like the manga version. But his version of L seemed more like a, I guess, autistic that's obsessed with serving justice.
And candy. Lots of candy.
And candy.
This is a very interesting. So coming from not knowing anything about the anime or the manga itself, and then seeing that character, that was an interesting character. Just in hearing within the movie, the very, I think it was like only like a couple lines worth of backstory for that character, and then seeing his intro and seeing how he's always popping some sort of like gummy bear or whatever candy he has. He always has candy with him for some reason. Yeah. And just all of those things and how he had the hood on and the mask on at all times. And it was just.
I mean, if you write him in the death book, you just go diabetes. Right? And then you're done.
Right. Well, no, that's not that out of the ordinary. I mean, right in this room, y'all can't see it on camera on Twitch, but Herb over there is snacking on one of those giant Twizzlers, you know, the one that you kind of wrap around like a lasso.
3-pound gummy worms, you know?
Yeah, I mean, we've warned about this several times, but dude, I mean, that's his thing. You know, he's also sitting there in a Cat in the Hat hat and a Jason mask.
Let me live my life. I don't feel good anymore.
All right, well, we talked about the cape at least, man. Why you got to wear this, though? I'm hoping they're putting together a mental picture right now. I want to see fan art of DJ Herb over there. It's going to be whack.
I will say this. For someone who hasn't seen the prior stories and then seen this as a movie, I felt betrayed that it skipped through all of that content. But I understand why, because it seemed like they wanted to cover the main parts or what they felt was the most important parts of a very big, very complex story that is Death Note, the manga, and anime. Or at least that's what it felt like to me. It felt like there's a lot there, but what I was given was probably trimming all the fat out and giving me the definitive, the most important parts of the story. Now, I don't know if that's true or not, but that's what it seemed like.
I think it is, but you can't really do that with a story of this type because it's all about like the tension building up and the suspense. This is a suspense laden story, and like at the forefront there should be a lot of like back and forth tension. L makes a move and then Light makes a move, and then L makes another move and Light makes another move, and in this one the story was more about the psycho girlfriend. You know, that's one thing I got. Played by Jessica McLeod. Wait, not Jessica McLeod. God damn, is she the right one here? Doggone it. Well, okay, I had the wrong name here. But the girlfriend in this movie was nuts. And it became more about her and Light's relationship. And L took almost the back seat, which I guess would be an artistic choice by the director. But it seemed to do this movie a disservice because, first of all, I will say it looked great. I thought it would look like complete garbage. And besides Light's ridiculous, like, frosted hair, I actually thought they got the design, like, down. And especially when you see Ryuk, when you see the Shinigami, the death spirit, that effect was crazy, and it looked as close to a realistic interpretation of the anime design as you could get, and it was nuts, man. And then you hear that voice; it is voiced by Willem Dafoe, and you were like, "That is as creepy as I would imagine Willem Dafoe looked if I'd never seen his face and only heard his voice. It was perfect. It was on point. The effects in this were awesome. It was dark, but it was tonally dark and visually dark, which was appropriate. You know, the anime has a lot of like daytime scenes, which I guess work for that format. But the darkness in this worked. It was more like Batman Begins, and every scene seemed to have like a hue over it, you know,
yeah,
which really worked.
Shot in a lens, you know what I mean? That kind of cast this, like Soderbergh does that a bunch, you know what I mean? He shoots in like blues and yellows a lot.
Yeah, I thought it worked.
So it's either like bright and like kind of washed, or it's just like darker and you're like, ugh, you know, kind of brings you down.
Exactly. This was right on point with that. This was dark. A lot of scenes at night, a lot of scenes in like dark areas, even when you first discover the Shinigami. Well, when Light first discovers the Shinigami, which...
Well, you mentioned Fincher, too, because Fincher shoots very dark
as
well.
Yes, Fincher does. The thing that first came to mind was The Game. Mm. The Game had that look where it's like, even if it's daytime, it's never really like that bright out. Everything just paints this picture of like, the world is dark. You know, and this is like a dark story. And I got that from Death Note. This was a dark story. It was shot beautifully. And the only things that bothered me were the choices they took in the character. Not the only thing. One of the main things, the major things that bothered me were the choices they took in the character interactions.
Well, it seems like indicative of Netflix in general. Like all the money in the world can just push something out there with a giant budget, but it's kind of hollow. You know what I mean? A little bit rushed. You know what I mean? Like, wow, this is a really great idea. People are going to love this. And they're kind of like hurrying it too much without giving it any soul.
Definitely.
So, you know what I mean? It's definitely like beautiful to look at. You're like, wow, this is their head's in the right place. But it's just they don't have, you know, the right parts to make this thing work. And so I think Netflix is doing that a lot. I mean, I'm glad they're really, you know, taking the effort to make things people want to see. Mm-hmm. But I just wish they would put some more care into that.
I think so too.
It definitely was a bit rushed. I felt the CG work was a little underwhelming, and there wasn't a whole lot of CG that was in this. But what was there, I could see sort of the cracks between the seams.
Well, that's the thing I have to disagree with you on. That goes into the look I was talking about, the effects. Because the only CG I remember seeing, and I may be wrong on this, maybe I'm misremembering, was the scenes with Light and the Shinigami. Besides that, I don't recall seeing that much work outside of that. So it was just the animation of that character. I think you got a look of another Shinigami as well. In this world, there are several Death Notes, and there are several different Shinigami that go with them.
But not in the movie.
Not in the movie.
Not in the movie. There's only one, and there's only one Death Note.
And I thought we got a hint of a second one.
Mm-hmm. I didn't see anything in there of a second one. I was expecting it, because I knew that there were more than one.
Yeah.
And I was trying to look out for it, but it never.
Well, with the way this movie tried to force them all in, I just...
It was just one. But some of the CG work I was talking about was like the gore effects, like when the first major death...
Oh, yeah, why is it so bloody, dude? Why is it so... It's bloody, like, it's raw, Herb. You've seen the anime and
the Japanese live version.
Okay, were they like gory for no reason?
No, it was more of a psychological thriller than a gore movie.
Okay, that's perfect. That's how it should be, according from what I know of this story in other formats. This was raw.
Yeah.
Like I'm talking Saving Private Ryan levels of like blood no reason whatsoever.
Why is he bleeding? Yeah. He's just talking. Yeah.
The very first kill, this guy's head goes.
Like a watermelon being shot with a shotgun.
It's like Rambo.
Someone took some footage of a Gallagher concert.
It's like Rambo versus First Blood.
Rambo. Mm.
So like First Blood is like a gritty kind of, you know,
that's
action movie.
That's an old-ass reference, but that's actually perfect.
And then Rambo, when he kind of revamped it, and you're like, wow, he's just blowing people's head off for no reason.
For
like,
no reason.
So much blood and arrows.
It was a trauma film.
Yes.
Yes. I was just thinking of the Toxic Avenger with the car running over the head.
Yeah.
Right? Same effect. It looked just like that, except it was CG and it looked like a cheap CG.
Lloyd Kaufman just jumps out and goes, be so good.
Okay. You know what? That right there, maybe I was too like weirded out. Maybe I turned my head or whatnot, because I remember it got raw and I didn't pay too much attention to those because it was just too much for me. After the first one, I was just like, okay, fine. It's going to be that kind of movie. Let me just power through this. It was unnecessary and it was excessive.
I'm
not complaining. I'm not one of
like
those.
I like some gore when it serves a story. You're right, but when it gets like egregiously like over the top, you're like, what the?
Yeah, man, you know, I'm saying, yeah. It's just like, I want to see a good movie, and I'm going in knowing Death Note. Even if I knew nothing about this movie, that would throw me completely for a loop, because it starts off as a story of teenagers interacting. This dude steps in front of a bully and tries to help out a girl, and then she's like a complete bee to him, and then it's like, okay, I see the dynamic going on here. And then, like, people getting rims lipped off and heads blown up and stuff. I'm like, yo, pick your direction and
yeah,
go with it, man.
I'm trying to remember the movie I watched once where it started out all right, and there's this girl on this boat, and then all of a sudden she – it was either her, she has somebody swallow this fishing line with fish hooks and then, like, rips it out.
What?
Yeah, it's pretty gory. And it was just like all of a sudden you're like, what the hell am I watching? Yeah,
I
want to
watch that.
Yeah,
no.
I'm
going to
find that. I'm going to find that.
Okay, maybe not Blue Lagoon. Return to Blue Lagoon?
Maybe.
I remember there was a girl on the boat. That's as far as I got.
Who slept with her brother? I don't even really know what's
going
on.
Yeah, wait, was he a brother?
Wasn't he?
Damn,
will you look up if on Blue Lagoon if she slept with her brother? I think that was her brother.
This is not the way I wanted Death Note review.
How did Blue Lagoon
he brought
get brought
it
up?
He said there was a girl in a boat. That's the most I remember. There was like a pregnant 12-year-old.
Brooke Shields sleeps with her brother. That's all I know.
Well, there was also Return of the Blue Lagoon with Mila Jovovich. That's where I discovered her.
Oh.
Yeah.
That's how you describe.
Was there more prenatal
sex? No, there wasn't. I'm sorry, Johnny. I know you're looking for that, but no, that's not the way it
was. Like that early. Yeah.
All right. Well, anyways, when it comes down to Death Note, I was really hoping not to sit here and kind of bag on this movie the whole time. There's not a lot to save it. I thought it looked really good. I did like Keith Stanfield's performance. Willem Dafoe as the voice was solid. I mean, I don't want to say, well, you know, it was Willem Dafoe, we expected as much and stuff, but we kind of did, and he delivered. He had the perfect voice for being as creepy as a Shinigami should be, and if I didn't know what Willem Dafoe looked like, which is a whole different level of creepy, I would think, wow, that's spot on. They must have got this nice deformed man to do the
Willem Dafoe is so good.
Yeah, there's a bit of his face on that.
There was, and that's sad because they weren't
trying to.
It's
mostly cheekbones.
It was unintentional. Willem Dafoe played Ryuk. I'm trying to see. I really want to know the girl's name because it was all about her for a long stretch of this movie. And at the end, it tried to ham fist in a few of the Twilight Zone esque twists that existed in the anime, yeah, which I thought were really good in the anime.
It's like, let's just stuff this in at the end.
Yeah, it
maybe
was.
Nobody will notice.
It was too perfect.
It was it sort of tied itself together very neatly. What they needed to do with this was they needed to show the impact and the weight of these players, right? This cat and mouse thing that the middle of the movie is all about,
mm-hmm,
and sort of show why they're making these bigger, convoluted decisions, these weighted decisions, like show the influence, right? The response to someone calling someone else out, right? Mm-hmm. When L goes on in front of the press, right?
Yeah.
So something like that. He does something, and it didn't really show how important that was and why they had to make the response that they did.
Well, that I think is a symptom of trying to cram such a huge story into such a short amount of time.
It's been translated so many times. It's like you're bound to lose stuff. It's like what story do you pick? What through line do you choose?
Original Japanese live action.
Yeah, and it's the thing, when it's been translated that many times, like there's so many fans that like this for so many different reasons. Mm-hmm. You're going to end up picking something when you translate it again that a bunch of people who originally liked it for something it's not going to get there.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? So people are going to be like, well, I don't really care about that part of the story. You know what I mean? And abandon it. So I don't know.
No, there's not much to say about this, I mean, besides what we've said. I think what it comes down to is I can't recommend this. I was kind of hoping to. I really hate when these projects are announced and they immediately get negative press because I'm like, what if it's good? You know, we have been surprised before. No one had any hopes of for the Christopher Nolan Batman movies after George Clooney, after the Joel Schumacher debacle, Batman and Robin. And then this
I don't know,
came
when I first
out,
saw those,
the best movies
when I first saw
time,
those trailers for Batman Begins, I was like, this is exactly what I want Batman to be. across ice all shabbled out and he's going to train. I'm like, that's exactly how
when
I want
when we saw
Batman.
The trailers, though, think about when it was just announced one image of Christian Bale in the Batman suit and the hood that and the cowl that looked like it didn't really fit.
Yeah, exactly, and he just came from making The Machinist, like when he was like 98 pounds.
You
know, like, what is this guy doing in this?
Like, you wouldn't believe.
And trust me, like, they gave so much grief to casting Heath Ledger in the second one. They're like, he can't do it. He's going to be terrible.
I'm afraid
what I mean?
To say I was kind of on point with
everybody was, and rightfully so. Then you're like, well, I'm stupid. I don't know about casting
at
all.
That dude from A Knight's Tale? Nah.
Yeah.
Or that dude from that 10 Things to damn it, what was it? 10 Simple Rules for Dating My Daughter?
Yeah. No. Every once in a while, everyone needs to check themselves. You're like, well, there's a reason I'm not in that profession. Like, I just don't know what
Wait,
I'm talking about.
I've got
you
a master's
have
in
to
film.
Do that.
You know how much that hurts?
Yeah,
that
it's
hurts
so
you to say?
True, though. I mean, he's
cutting deep.
Nolan said that about Dunkirk too when they cast Harry Styles. He's like, well, I cast Heath Ledger as the Joker.
Point.
He's like,
Very
I can,
point,
I know what I'm doing. Is basically what he was saying. He's like, you don't, I do. Just shut up. It was the nicest way to say shut the hell up.
Adam Willis pulling up punches.
It's true. That's what he was doing, right?
No,
it has to be that way.
I'm agreeing with you. It just
we can still bicker about stuff, and that's important to it as well. But every once in a while, we just need to acknowledge that we're wrong.
Wanda Sykes was still the best cast with Wu Tang. I don't care what you say.
Yes. Yes, that will never not be true in this room.
All right. Well, the movie's Death Note. It's available now on Netflix. Death Note, you want to find the Western version, the American versions, the 2017 versions, basically. And I can't recommend this, dude. This is just a thumbs down, and it hurts to do so. But
there's always reruns of Friends on Netflix, right? If you have to say it, if you don't like this.
I'm guessing the reaction's the same from both of y'all?
Yeah, kind
of. For Death Note?
Yeah.
I actually recommend it to people who have never seen Death Note. Give this one a go. It's not. Don't expect anything great. It's all right, and it might turn you on to a more interesting story, which is Death Note, the anime or manga.
Oh, snap. Nice. Okay, all right. No, good
approach. Yeah, this is an introduction to Death Note, sure. If it piques your interest to go further, right? That can't be a bad thing.
No, not at all. Sure. Experiment. You know, do what you want. It's college. Live it up. All right. So if you heard anything in that you want to chime in on, hit us up.
Consent, people.
GeekTownRadio@gmail.com. Also, hit us up. We're on Facebook. We're on Twitter. You know, shoot us a message later. Let us know what's going down. But, dude, Johnny.
You guys played a game.
Yes, we did, my friend. Wow. All right, I'm going to give a quick
this
breakdown.
This is an aggressive name for a game as well.
Blasters of the Universe.
You know what?
And it has everything in the world to do with He-Man.
It
has nothing in the world to do with He-Man.
Except for the color scheme. It's color scheme? Ripped straight out of He-Man.
That was my
all
acapella group name.
All the purples and the pinks. And,
the color scheme is not, man.
My acapella group name in
this. He-Man was dark red and black.
What are you talking about?
And then more blacks. And He-Man was written, was like space fantasy.
Skeletor was purple and lavender.
Skeletor was
the
blue with a yellow face.
Blue? He was
blue.
Purple and lavender.
Skeletor
man.
Was blue. Where'd you get this from? Okay.
I'm
going to Google a picture of Skeletor for you. Hold on one second. We're talking about Blasters of the Universe. This is a new VR bullet hell hate you for the love of God why video game from on Steam right now. Dang it. I forgot the name of the developers here. I'll look that up in a bit, but this game is ridiculous. The storyline is what happened? Are you?
Yeah, we're good.
I got some static there. The storyline is Blast of the Universe is a 1993 two CD set by Bootsy Collins and his new rubber band. The album first released on
what?
Exactly. That was the thing that messed me up. There's actually an album
it's
by
like
Bootsy Collins
from this. Yeah.
From Problem with Funkadelic.
From Funk, yeah.
There was an album called Blast
Come
of the
on,
Universe.
Baby.
They released years ago, like 20-something plus years ago, and that tripped me up for a long
time.
I'm going
to do Bootsy Collins voice the rest of the show.
You doing Bootsy Collins, baby?
All right, Pat. Give me the review, baby. I'm coming.
No, Blast of the Universe is it's a bullet hell game. It lets you build a badass gun from thousands of combinations and then get ready to duck and dodge your way through a ton of bullets and nostalgic and nerve-wracking VR. Basically, it's a game. It throws you into a location. You're fighting against random enemies that want to kill you for no reason,
and
then
shoot everybody, and then you move on.
It's a very Twilight Zone premise. And essentially, you're in a place. How do you get in this place? You don't know. Why everyone to get you in this place? You have no idea. All you know is you need to survive in Blast of the Universe. That's where you say this.
You're in a room. You can't leave. Just kill everybody.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It places you there with no real explanation. There is an intro, and it doesn't really have any purpose. It's pretty much the intro is more of the story of like the world's narrator. Yeah. It's like playing Fallout, and instead you don't know your backstory. You know three dogs. You know.
Well, I don't think it's the villain.
No, he's not the. Well, I mean, maybe he is the villain, and everyone else works for him, but they don't establish that. As far as I know, as far as I got from.
He's straight up the villain. He's always taunting you throughout the whole way. He's throwing his minions at you in order for you to kill them.
He's okay. The villain, baby.
Because okay, I figured if he was the villain in a game like this, they would have it be like Dr. Robotnik, or Dr. Eggman. He comes in, he attacks, like the minions attack you, but then at the end you're fighting him in some contraption, and then you beat him, and he runs off, and then the next level you're fighting him in a different contraption, you know, and he runs off in a different contraption, that type of setup, instead of him just being the overlord, because then you're never going to face this dude. This game is hard as balls, man, it's ridiculous, and every single level you'd think would ramp up gradually and let you build your skills and then fight against different levels of enemies, no. Within like 30 seconds, I was already being just had my ass handed to me. This game is hateful, disturbing, raw, punishing, unforgiving.
How many hours did you play?
I think it said something anti-Semitic. Okay, the game is hostile from the jump.
How many hours did you sink in?
I played the game for about 3, maybe 4 hours.
Okay.
Yeah, I got a good hour, in between an hour and 2 hours. So the big catch about this, not only is it a bullet hell. This is a very unique
game. Emphasis on hell.
Yep. This is a very unique game because it is a VR game, and the bullet hell aspect requires that you physically move yourself away from the bullets. So you are Matrix-style dodging bullets. I was getting down on my knees, dodging left and right, trying to swivel my head. Now your head itself is actual the targeting range, or your body that you're moving.
It's VR, so all this is actually you moving your body.
Yeah, it's the Vive part of VR, so it's room scale. So everything you do and the controllers that you're holding on to, those are moving one to one. Your head is moving one to one, exactly how you move it. You turn your head, you're looking around. Everything around you is exactly as it would be if it were in real life. And your head is the only part that can be hit. So what you see with the bullets is that is purple
that
and
is
lavender. That is
blue,
purple
man.
And lavender
blue
right there, man.
That is blue. Her.
That is totally
from a distance.
Purple and
what
lavender.
Color is that? Blue. Thank you. Oh, stop it. Right now. He's trying to.
He's wearing a purple scarf with a blue chest. Man, he's. Come on, you're both wrong.
All right, fine. Just settling in a previous argument. All right. Continue.
So you have to physically move your head and sort of dodge between these bullets and avoid taking shots to your face. And the way the enemies will attack, they'll shoot like a line of bullets at you. They'll whether it be a horizontal line, a vertical line, or a ring, or a box of bullets. And you're constantly having to dodge and weave in between those. And on your left hand, you'll have your sub-weapon or sub-item, and on your right arm, you'll have your main gun. And there's different, as Pat said, you can construct those in different ways.
Yeah,
and
there's a bunch of different firing modes. There's a bunch of different barrels to choose from that would range from like triple shot, from wide shot, rapid fire. It felt like...
So it was like Judge Dredd's gun.
Yeah,
kind of. I felt like gameplay-wise, it took a lot from Gunstar Heroes. If you've ever played Gunstar Heroes, it's an old game. It's more Contra style. But what you could do is you'd acquire different types of different ammo types that you could use. One, you could ramp up the strength of that. You could cross that with different types of firing. This is a far more advanced level of that. But utilizing the different ammo types and blending them to use them to your advantage.
Yep. Now you don't. You're not able to change this in between levels. So you sort of, it's like a loadout. So you're building your loadout, and then you enter the level, and you're trying to get through to the boss at the end of the level and shoot them like a typical
bullet
hell
game
is. Yeah,
which you will never do. The game hates you, and it lets you know, like right off the bat, this sucker is unforgiving. Okay, it starts off with, I see a unit there, I'm going to shoot this guy. I see a unit there, I'm going to shoot this guy. There's one over there. What's that from above? Oh, it's a solid wall of bullets coming at me. You know, there is no, like, ducking, bobbing, weaving. I just have to use this shield and pray. And you can choose different types of shield. The one the God forbid you choose the wrong one, because you can't go back and switch it. There's no power-ups or nothing where it's like, okay, I can swap out the mirror shield for the reflective shield and stuff like that. The clear wall shield. Or no, none of that. You are stuck with this piece of... I'm sorry, Johnny, you were saying?
The shields are great.
The shields were okay. Ah. The shields I used were great.
Oh.
But they weren't. No, some of them were garbage.
It was so because this is in VR.
Yeah.
Your arms, unlike any other first-person game that involves shooting mechanics, your arms are separate and they're detached and decoupled from where you are looking. So you can look straight down the line, down the center, and aim left with your left arm to the left where you can't see, and aim with your right arm to your right where you can't see, and those are doing whatever it is. They're either shooting an enemy. You can sort of look, peek right, hold your gun out, shoot that enemy, and while you're shooting that enemy, look left and make sure there's no incoming bullets on your left-hand side, and hold up your shield and block some of those things. Meanwhile, dodge and move your head out of the way of whatever bullets is coming your way.
You know what? I like that. But I found the most effective combination actually turned out to be crossing my hands and having the shield right there in the direction I'm shooting, so I can deflect while I'm shooting, and I can deflect and off and run my offense at the same time. Yeah. So I turn this way and I'm actively blocking. I turn this way and I'm not just blocking; I'm also shooting back, so I can take out more. I can address more units that way.
Yeah,
which is kind of a waste of the mechanic.
Well, it's a bit tricky.
It's more style.
Bad Boys 3, I don't know they made
that. They're coming.
I was doing that too. I was mixing up my style because I was failing hard because the game is very hard.
Yes, but the game will kill you, then spit on your body.
So is the difficulty off-putting?
And then go and mock your children.
Is the difficulty off-putting, or do you want to like come back and like beat it like out of spite?
Honestly, that's the sad thing. It's like, as tedious as this was, I had fun. But I don't see myself going back to play it too often.
Is it because of just the difficulty?
Well, no. It's like after a while it gets boring because it's repetitive.
Yeah.
You know, it
just bludgeoning you with bullets and you're like, okay, this is all there is.
Especially when you get to like the bosses. Once you figure out the pattern, then it's just like, how long can I hit them before they go down? There's no
matter of execution.
Yeah, there's no too much. There's not too much variation in the style.
Well,
if they had incorporated as the bosses have two or three different firing modes. You know, you get them down this level, and then he switches up to this. You know, one thing I hated is when Fallout would do this, when you're fighting an enemy and it gets to a certain point, and then it quote unquote mutates. And now it's got new health and an extra ability.
Yep.
That pissed me off there, but I think this game would have benefited from that because essentially once I figure out the pattern, I can duck now, shoot now, move here now, move there now, shoot again, duck again, and then move. It's like once I figure that out, then it's how many times can I do that before I get to the boss? And even then, I just have to keep doing that over and over again, and it takes forever. You can be in a boss fight for 10 minutes or more in this.
These enemies are pretty spongy. So the gameplay, the general gameplay of this is very, very arcadey. It's very old school. It is like the bullet hell games, right? You are meant to analyze the waves.
I feel like this was designed to suck quarters out of my pocket.
Yeah, yeah. You're meant to play the level. You know where the patterns are. You know how the enemies are coming at you. It is repetition is sort of built into this old school design, so that's sort of coming with it. And the boss itself, right? He's always thrown like the same kind of insults, or not the boss, but the evil villain. The overboss. He's throwing these insults at you left and right.
He's making these corny comments. Yeah, this jive suck up there. And what sucks is I want to shoot him at many points, and I can't. Like you start off the game with a nice close up shot of him, and you can't just like pick him off in the forehead and go home. That's what I wanted to do. I'm trying to think. Well, what are those games that go like really? Oh, my favorite part of the Metal Gear games is at points you won't know you probably won't know you can do this because the game won't tell you a damn thing. But you can like snipe a boss like the first time you see them, and the game doesn't tell you can. But you snipe them, and then you'll go through the rest of the game and like be able to skip over that whole part. Or like in Metal Gear Solid 3 Snake Eater. The end boss is just like this really old dude. So you can skip the whole fight by just turning the game off and not playing it for a week. And then you jump back in and it says he's died of old age.
What? That's so good.
You know, stuff like that. Well, I kind of wish when you saw this dude descend and he's in your face, you just get one good shot on him.
Who's
bam.
The first guy that figured that out too?
Just you leave know? The game. I figured they probably fought him. They got frustrated. Because this dude is friggin' ridiculously hard.
Yeah.
Obnoxiously hard. Yeah. But They got frustrated. I've done this. I've had games. Ah, oh, forget this thing. I'm never gonna play it again.
Left it for a week though.
Well, yeah. After a while,
I'll come back for an hour.
A week is nothing, man. I've left games for like months. Like, forget this, and then I finish off something else.
I'll leave more holes in my wall than I will the game.
Yeah, I remember those days too. It's like Tasmania for the Genesis. Awful piece of
I had posters next to my bed that I would cover up just the holes I punched. Like that. It's like, why are you buying all these posters? Like, I gotta, not let my mom know. I just destroyed the house.
I'd say the difficulty with this game is that more modern games include this RPG mechanic where if you're hitting this difficulty wall, you can eventually level up past it in order to get around, right? You can improve your character. But in this, your improving is physical skill. You have to physically be fit enough in order to dodge around these bullets quick enough to be aware of what's around you, turn your head quick enough.
This sounds exactly like Edge of Tomorrow, the movie with Tom Cruise. Yeah. This is the exact basis of that movie.
Yeah, that's actually,
It's like you just jump into the middle of this war and all of a sudden you just got to get physically better or you're going to die every time.
That's exactly what this is like. That is absolutely correct.
Great movie, though.
Yeah, no,
damn good movie. Damn Live, good Die, movie. Repeat if you're from overseas, a more accurate title. And I think probably my favorite movie from Tom Cruise.
Yep, Bill Paxton. And
that's Counting the Outsiders.
That is a really good movie.
He was good in that. Let's just not make a joke, but he was great.
If anybody didn't get that, he's in that movie for all of maybe a minute.
He's
and
got
and
a few
tops.
Scenes. Yeah, he's
That was Tom Cruise before he got the teeth fixed.
Yeah, he's
so
Steve.
Still all crooked. He had a hole.
So Blasters of the Universe. The big drive for this game is after you beat everything, because it looks like there's only a limited, probably like 5 to 7 levels.
Yeah, it's still pretty early on, and they've only gotten to a certain point in development. I figure they'll expand and they'll patch the hell out of it. They've already changed the design so much. I checked out some videos of the earlier gameplay. The game's been out for a couple of weeks. We just got it now. Yep. And the design from mid-August to now is it's almost a completely different game, like aesthetically, visually. They've got a proper HUD now. It works very well. The environments are filled in where it used to be just like open space. Like that's what I thought. This was just like open space, kind of like a first-person flight sim where you have to shoot things off in the horizon. You have no sense of depth perception. You just have to shoot it in its direction and not really know which way it's going, so you can't lead a target. And it's kind of like just out in the ether. Mm. And then they've enclosed the environments, and it's a lot more manageable now. And even then, ridiculously hard. Obnoxiously hard.
You think that's something they change as they keep
somebody
going?
Somebody had a grudge, an axe to grind. Somebody had something to prove. And they hate you as a player.
I read some.
Nothing is forgiving.
I read some of the comments from.
It makes you hate the world and yourself.
I read some of the comments from the earlier iterations.
Slap your mama.
It was actually harder earlier, so they are easing it a little
yeah,
bit.
They are.
So what do you think the purpose of that, though? Do you think they do that intentionally,
or
do you think they're just like,
if
a game's way hard, I'm just like, okay, I'm done.
Well, there's only 5 levels, right? There's only 5 to 7 levels. There's a limited number of levels.
There's
each level you can beat within
too.
Like 5 to 10 minutes.
That goes into it. Yeah.
It's 5 to 10 minutes per level.
It was 5 to 10 minutes per level, and then
was it like implied that
that level
too?
Well,
if you see the leaderboards, that's the big drive of this game too. Is that leaderboards is the real reason.
Well, that's the old school style.
You
know what I mean? Like, okay, I gotta get that high score.
Online
leaderboards.
Yeah, you read the leaderboards. Ass. I can't let that be the top.
The ass was Galaga at my local movie theater for at least 3 years, by the way, and I was ass.
Yeah, poo, ass, D-I-K, sex. Sex was always up
this
there
was yeah my local Galaga at the movie theater was like it's like the episode of Seinfeld when he's playing Frogger. He doesn't want to unplug it to lose his high score, so he tries to get across the street and ends up getting it.
That was before the days of extended batteries, and this is like I had an extension cord and the right idea, just the wrong time of day and trying to run it across like Frogger.
So good though, yeah.
I do want to say the soundtrack to this, it's a retro wave soundtrack which fits with its very 80s neon color vibe.
There's like
I love the soundtrack. It's actually really good.
An 80s sounce going on.
Oh yeah.
Yes.
Totally.
Oh yeah.
You know what I mean? Especially with those retro scores. You know, we got what's the Netflix series? Stranger Things.
Stranger Things. Yeah.
Is doing
Stranger
it,
Stranger
but
Things,
before that movie.
Drive?
Well, Drive was definitely had that kind of synthy pop score.
Yeah, you talking about the hip hop one?
But I'm talking about the horror movie. It Follows. Yeah, that had this 80s horror synth score.
Not the exact place I'd go, but no, you make a good point, yeah.
But that's, yeah, that was completely, like, reviving that whole thing. So yeah, there's definitely this 80s, like, synthy thing going on.
Think about this more along the lines of, like, Far Cry Blood Dragon.
Yes.
Or, dang, what's that retro game? The top-down one?
Oh, Hotline Miami.
No, Retro City Rampage. Hotline Miami too, but no, this is more like Retro City Rampage.
Yep. River City Rampage?
No, Retro.
City Rampage. Hotline Miami, very much.
Yeah. Dude, the 8-bit score for Double Dragon 2 was heady as hell.
Yeah, but that was Double Dragon 2.
That stuff was trippy. Whoever did that was a master.
Yeah, you can't. Come on, baby. You got to live in the now.
Well, come on, baby.
Universe. Soundtrack could have been my Bootsy Collins. That would have been amazing.
You got a little bass in that, baby.
Oh, yeah. He'd be like, if the game called Blasted Universe. What now, man? Say what?
Let me sleep with your wife.
Oh, also, if you're looking for a good workout, this is the game.
Yes, again, man, VR. Sweating. So all this, like, bobbing, weaving, movement we're talking about, flipping the arms, like left
Paul
right,
of the rapper.
And this stuff. Yeah. You do need Roger Rabbit to move the game.
Well, jump kick.
Anyways, dude, it comes down to, I recommend this game, but be aware, it will kick your ass. Up and down the street.
So if you're a novice, I guess, you're just like, well, whatever. That'll suck.
If you're a novice, the game will be painful for a long, long time. And then once you get amazing, it'll become tedious. But I still recommend Cats check it out. It's available right now on the Steam store.
And it's $15. And yeah, like Pat said, I'd highly recommend it too. It's really cool. It's become probably my new number one VR game to check out. Yep.
Okay. All right. Also, keep in mind, it is VR, so you will need a headset to play.
A very expensive, not worth buying headset.
Wow. Okay. All right.
The game's worth it, but the headset to play it isn't.
Yeah. Just trying to get a little real. All right. Well, the game is Blasters of the Universe by Secret Location. So that's kind of a tight name. If you want to check it out, it's on Steam right now. Dude, if you want to tell us about it, geekdownradio@gmail.com or go to geek-down.com. Check us out. Leave us a note in the comment section. See what's going on. Also, from there, you can get all the social media links in the About section. And, you know, do subscribe. Subscribe your ass off. Do what you got to do. Man, now, dude, we got to close out with, I got to check out Vixen the movie. Did anyone else get to check out Vixen the movie?
Did not.
I guess, did anyone knowingly get to check out Vixen the movie?
Not on purpose.
All right, well, I say that because, I'll give a quick synopsis. An orphan from Africa inherits a mystical totem that allows her to gain the strength, speed, and courage of any several on the planet. Oh, sorry, any animal on the planet. Now known as Vixen, she fights bravely to protect the innocent. Vixen is a character from the DC Universe played by two women. The one focused on this one is Mari. She is a member of the Justice League, and this is a series, an animated series, about her origins. What I mentioned earlier is we've seen this before. A couple of years ago, DC released a series of shorts, about 5 minutes each episode, centered around Mari as a character who gets this totem that gives her animal powers, and she's learning to use them, she's learning about it, and people are trying to kill her and take it, how she used it to defend the city, etc., etc. That was something we spoke about, and it was very short. We were hoping it got an extended series, you know, a follow-up, and it turns out it did. And last year, 2016, it got a season 2, which they did the same way. They did, I believe it was 6 5-minute episodes. The whole season added up to an hour. And they advertised nothing. So I didn't even know about it until I checked this out. Because we talked about that initial series. We were jazzed about it. We were excited about it. We pimped the hell out of it. And we're like, hopefully this evolves into something because it could be a really cool character. And I have not heard about it since.
Yeah,
and
no,
that's a grave injustice, I think. No pun intended.
Well, it's kind of fun that way, too, when you discover it and you feel like it's like only you that enjoys it.
Well, maybe.
You know what I mean?
Cool,
but you're
some...
right. It should be pushed if it's good.
Yeah, this is a DC
company. You know what I mean?
Company,
it's like you're releasing it. You know what I mean? Like, put some, you know, backing behind it. DC's got the money.
DC's got the money.
Yeah,
I think they're hurting after that last Batman Superman.
Yeah, they can put out crap, which they do consistently, and it still makes millions of dollars. So, yeah, they should put a little effort into stuff that's actually of quality.
I think so. What we're talking about right now is Vixen the movie. And the movie, I mentioned those previous shows because Vixen the movie is those shows stitched together in the one complete movie, quote unkote complete movie, because
kind of repackaged and served out as like a kind of the gestalt This is the whole of it, right?
That's exactly what it was. And I'm a little bummed because the only place you could watch this, at least right now, if you didn't catch the live run on TV, is on the CW Seed web channel, or unless you buy it, you pay for it, on YouTube. Which I have no problem with folks paying for this. It's not that much on YouTube. It's like $4. And I think it's worth it for just like a quick watch. The problem is I don't think it has much rewatchability, and it doesn't look like they're expanding this. This was released as a promotion for Vixen, the character of Vixen being added to the upcoming season of DC's Legends of Tomorrow TV show. So they released this existing series that actually could have gotten some juice, and DC's been doing really good stuff in the animated universe. This was released as little more than promotion for an upcoming appearance, possibly a regular ongoing edition, but of another show, man. That brings me down because Vixen is one of the few prominent black characters in the DC universe.
Mm-hmm.
Not just black, but female characters. And after Wonder Woman, you'd think every female character would be like prime for a solid push. Black Canary's been there like ace in the hole forever. She's in this show for like 6 minutes tops. You know, which I guess when you consider the episodes is like more than one episode.
Right.
But as a whole, we're talking about a quote-unquote movie.
You think that's like a property they'd explore now?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Big Barda, Frost, Killer Frost, which is apparently going back and forth as like a good character now. They're still like they're debating what they want to do with these things. They're kind of all over the board, but at the very least, you've got ground to work with now. Power Girl has been the most questionable figure forever, you know, and it's never explored. Starfire even has juice coming from Teen Titans, and as sad as it is to admit, kind of Teen Titans Go for the sole purpose of the character being, I guess, identifiable to newer generations of fans now. So Vixen is a character you could really do a lot with, and I heard nothing about this at all. And this is a movie that exists, the movie that's existed for at least like 4 months, several months, and the series itself is 2 years in the making. So it's kind of a damn shame. When it comes down to the movie, however, I feel DC didn't necessarily drop the ball on this, but they didn't give it their all. Because after the hits, DC's been knocking out of the park in the animation realm. Mm. I didn't think Vixen measured up.
Really?
Yeah. I thought they focused too much on trying to ham-fist the character's origin, which was never a big point in the comics.
It's a common mistake with, you know, the adaptation of the comics and stuff like that, is botching the origin.
That's
kind of like heavy-handed with that.
Well, I mean,
look at how many Spider-Mans we've gotten.
Oh, don't.
It's true though. You know, how many times do we have to see Uncle Ben die?
It's like I feel like someone had a vendetta against that poor bastard. It's like no, we're gonna
gotta relive your uncle dying over and over. We're
gonna tell the story of Peter Parker, now longtime Spider-Man, retired Spider-Man, businessman who's making headway for younger heroes. No. Let's see that mother Ben Parker get cacked again.
One more time. Let's run that
really?
Back.
Yeah. Let's see him die on screen, and then have repeated flashbacks. I'm thinking at least seven in this movie. Like, really?
It's funny how Wolverine gets all of the, you know, old Logan origin story, all of those offshoots, but no other comic character gets it.
That's a damn shame. There's so much good material to work with the comic characters, and they feel the need to force the origin stories.
Do you think
again
that's like people cashing in on the hype of comic books that aren't really comic book fans that don't know the stuff?
I don't know, because I remember when I first got into comics, I didn't know anything about them, but they weren't feeding me origin stories again. Origin stories are when a character's already established and you think it might be interesting to know where they came from. You know, you show me an origin story, you're essentially showing me the character before they can do anything cool that I would care about. If I'm going to buy action figures, I don't want to see them learning to use this thing. I want to see them using it and doing cool stuff when they know
what
it's
capable. The origin story is not the first thing you get, is what you're
Absolutely
saying.
Absolutely
right.
not. No, it shouldn't be. It should never be.
It's like, I like this guy, now I want to know more, like, well, how did he start? So the origin story comes after, you're right, and instead we're getting it now, like, that's the first thing you see.
Yeah, you know gotcha. the first one to do it right, which sadly was the first one to do it right on several levels and really gets no respect nowadays, and I partially blame it to continuing the series, is Blade.
You just see his mom kind of like gets that look up and it flashes in his face. Like,
that's
my mom.
All died. You need. I didn't want to see like, oh, well, you know, this is him growing up with Whistler and learning to
shoot
a gun.
Yeah, I don't need a teenage Blade.
No one wants that.
You know, it's like a teenage Jesus. You just forget about it. You know what I mean? What's like, a 13-year-old Jesus look like? I don't give a shit.
That Bible, they had it right. You know, just skip the fluff and go right to the good stuff.
Right. But that's it. You're right. With Blade, you get his mom just doing that thing. You get a flash. He looks, sees the same thing. You're like, okay, this guy's got a scarred past.
I really
Bang,
feel like
that's
that.
It.
That should have been on the marketing. It's Blade, better than a teenage Jesus.
You're right. That would have been made some really
right
good
there.
Copy. That's
that
a great
a
copy they missed
hit.
Out on.
That is absolute. Well, there
Blade,
was,
better than teenage Jesus.
One of my favorite books, oddly enough, is just a quick sidebar while we're talking about it, is a book by Christopher Moore called Lamb, The Gospel According to Biff, Jesus' Childhood Friend. And it paints the story of the teenage Jesus. But it's not like, well, you know, I went to this monastery and I went to this, I fed these lepers and I clothed these. No, it basically makes Jesus into Batman, or more apropos, it makes Jesus into Samurai Jack. So it's like he turns 13. He's like, well, you know, Pharaoh's killing these people and, you know, the rulers are kind of evil. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to travel across the world. I'm going to learn every fighting style, every martial art. You know, I'm going to learn every Zen technique. And then I'm going to come back and kick some ass. And he does. And it's awesome. Because it's like told from the perspective of his homeboy, who's like, you know, you my boy, man. I got your back. I'm not letting you go out there by yourself. We're going to do this. And it's like Jesus goes and meets with these people and he's learning techniques and learning all these martial arts. And he's got his boy here who's going to all these places as well.
His name is Biff. Jesus,
his name is Biff.
That's so good.
It's a real biblical name, Biff. But while Jesus is learning the sword fight and, you know, to learn to tap his chi, Biff is getting some ass at the local brothel. Without drinking with local...
The oldest. On Labor Day, by the way, the oldest.
It existed back then. Yeah. Well, a real way to approach labor. Mm. But DC could have had a really solid hit with this one. At the very least, even if they went with the route that they went, advertising this would have drawn so much interest, I think, and so much appeal for this character. And they might be banking on the appearance of Vixen in the... Legends of Tomorrow TV series, but I don't think that's enough. I think that's going to be a disservice to it because the way they've approached the characters that exist now in that series is you haven't really been able to see what they're fully capable of, and I think they're doing it like an old-school Justice League, and I mean old-school Justice League, with the first incursion of them was these are the characters that exist in their own titles and aren't really selling, so let's put them in a major property to try to
boost
get
it
some,
a little bit. Yeah.
Exactly. I think that's what they've been doing, and they're not representing them correctly.
It's
Firestorm
like kind of being
is
on a good baseball team and you're not really a good player. You know what I mean? But the team's all right.
Okay, yeah, no, I get that. And it's like they're really hoping for like that choice season, that Mighty Ducks moment,
yeah,
where you all come together and become
like, oh, I got a ring. Yeah, you didn't really play, but yeah, I got the ring.
Hey, man, that bench was warm when those cats came off the field because of me. You know,
Martian Manhunter.
It's DC's Vixen colon the movie, and I will say that at the very least, it's something. You know, it's something. That is a B level character that is still worthy of a lot of accolade, and this I'm hoping is just the first step in really bringing her out to the public. And then DC, I'm hoping the Legends of Tomorrow series goes gangbusters with Vixen's with the addition of Vixen, and they do another animated series because they've really got a lot of ground to grow on. And this is a character they could really do interesting things with because she's not Superman. You know, she's not ridiculously overpowered and facing these cosmic threats from nowhere. She's someone who can embody the spirit of animals and utilize that. It's a ground level hero, which is something they've overshadowed for so long. And I think there's a lot of story there that needs to be tapped. And this could be the way they tap it. So I'm hoping they do well. And I think I'll definitely praise it for is the voices of the other DC heroes. In this animated show, were voiced by the same actors who play them in the live action show.
Okay.
Firestorm was played by the same dude that does Firestorm. Professor Stein was the same Professor Stein. You know, the Flash was done by dude from the Flash, and the guest did on Arrow, and the Green Arrow was voiced by what's his name that plays Arrow on Arrow. You know, so it's like that was consistent, and I like that. I thought that was pretty dope. It's Vixen, the movie, the animated movie. I recommend cats check it out. Deal with the tons of commercials you'll have to because, dude, there were tons of commercials forced into this. I think more than TV appearance. Like 6 to 8 minutes of commercials. Jesus. Really? But
like
you know
skate
what?
Skate magazine.
Yeah, but it's worth seeing if just to support this project, because then they'll see folks want to see this and they'll get their asses in gear. Because they didn't advertise it before, they didn't advertise it now, and I think that definitely robs the audiences of something that could really be great. Vixen, the animated series, and the movie, thumbs up. Dude, I think we're out of time. I've talked till I'm hoarse. All right.
You look good, though, bud. That's important.
Thanks, man. You're too kind. This has been the Geek Down here on WMF Radio. I want to remind you all, check us out at geekdownradio@gmail.com. And if you heard anything you want to chime in on, hit us up at geekdownradio@gmail.com. Also, seek us out on Facebook, on Twitter, we're on YouTube, on iTunes. You can subscribe there. Leave us a review, all that good stuff. Man, and we will catch you all. Until then, we'll catch you all next time. Until then, peace.
Peace.
Hello, musicians.